understands the life is purposeless, only he can experience the meaning of living. Meaning of living is bliss, but there is no purpose. The more you think about purposes, more you will create worries, more you will try to squeeze maximum from life. But when you try to squeeze maximum from life, life is much more intelligent than you. Please be very clear, life is much more intelligent than you. When you try to squeeze maximum from life, it just slips away through your fingers. Life is like a river. If you put your hands in the river and keep it open, it will always be there in your hand. But if you try to catch it, if you try to hold, you will have only empty hand. You will have only empty hand. Life is a flowing river. If you just allow it to happen, it will continuously flow in you. The moment you try to catch it, the moment you try to possess it, you will have only empty hands. You will not be able to have the life itself. You will not be able to have the very life. Be very clear, the moment you understand life is purposelessness, the purposelessness of life, you start experiencing the meaning of living, the bliss. The moment you drop the goal, very path itself becomes beautiful. Your whole life will become beautiful. Your whole life will become ecstasy. Nothing to achieve separately. The whole thing is purposeless. The moment you experience in your inner space that nothing is going to be with you permanently, or nothing is permanent, the moment you understand that, a deep healing, a deep cooling breeze enters into your consciousness. Your whole inner space will be healed. You have so many thousands of wounds in your inner space. Wounds created by your own desires. Wounds created by your failures. Wounds created by others. Wounds created by your near and dear ones. All these wounds will be healed with this single one medicine. I can say single one meditation. It is not medication, meditation. This one meditation of understanding life is purposeless. This one meditation of realizing whatever you achieve, it is just nothing. Nothing is going to be with you. The so-called great, I don't want to say he's great, that is a so-called great. Fool who did so many murders cannot be called as great. Please be very clear. Never teach, at least to your kids, the Alexander is great. Then you are inspiring them to do murders. Then you are inspiring them to enter into the wars. Unconsciously you are putting all these ideals in front of them. Never do that. The Alexander, the so-called great. Of course, he did one good thing. Unfortunately or fortunately, he met one enlightened master in India. We can say unfortunately only, because this guy don't know how to respect him. He met that enlightened person. Somehow, he got the idea from his guru, bring one enlightened master from India and Vedas from India, I'll change the whole society. So this guy decided he will take at least one enlightened person from India. Some of you got the chance to meet an enlightened person. He invites him, please come to our country. The master just laughs. No, 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 I don't want to come anywhere. I want to be here only. He says, no, 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 please come, I'll give you a big palace. Here you are lying like a beggar, without even cloth, without even having enough cloth. Please come there. I'll give you a big palace and all the comforts. He just laughs. He says, no, I'm quite happy here. I don't want to come. You know, the kings, what is the next step they will take? First, through greed he tried. Because it did not work, he wanted to try through fear. He just took his sword out. If you are not ready to come, you will be killed. Just in front of the naked sword, this master is laughing. Please be very clear, laughing now is very difficult. Now, laughing now is very easy. But laughing in front of an naked sword is very difficult. And especially person who is holding is a king. If he kills, there is nobody to question. There is nobody to question. But in front of the naked sword, he is laughing. He says, fool, you are a great liar. He just says, he straight away looks into the eyes of Alexander. The master looks into the eyes of Alexander and says, fool, you are a great liar. First time Alexander is shaken. First time he was shaken. He says, are you not afraid? Master says, you can never kill me. You may destroy this body. You cannot kill me. The courage or the confidence of experience, the courage which is expressed by the spiritual experience, what we studied in Gita, Nainan Jindandi Sastrani, Nainan Dagati Pavagaha. It has become experience. Atman cannot be killed. Atman cannot be destroyed. It cannot be burned. It has become experience for him. That is why the courage and the confidence. He just laughs. Slowly Alexander starts thinking. If he can laugh in front of my naked sword, how courageous he must be. First time he was shaken because he has never seen anybody who can laugh in front of naked sword, who can laugh in front of death. Even he is afraid. Please be very clear. All so-called great warriors are deep cowards. They kill others before they are killed. That's all. Continuously they are afraid of death. That is why they kill others. Be very clear. Warriors are the worst cowards. Just to hide their cowardness or to escape from the fear, they start killing others. He was totally shaken. He was shocked to see the courage of this master. Then he asks him, please tell me something. How you are so courageous, bold? Then master asks, why did you come to India? Alexander says, to conquer India. After that, what are you going to do? I'll conquer the next country. After that, what are you going to do? I'll conquer the next country. After that, I'll conquer the whole world. After that, I'll relax and enjoy. Master says, fool, that is what I am doing now. Don't you see? That is what I am doing now. The same thing I am doing now. Part four, you need to go around and conquer the whole world to relax and enjoy. That is what I am doing now. only a man who understood the purposelessness of life can relax and enjoy. I think this master gave a glimpse of the truth to Alexander. That is why Alexander says to his ministers, after my death, when you carry my dead body, please keep my hands out. Please keep my open hands out. Let people know even the Alexander did not carry anything with him. Even Alexander did not carry anything with him. This story is a beautiful story. You need to understand three things. First thing, the courage and the confidence radiated by an enlightened person. Next thing, the purposelessness of our running. What for Alexander is running? To relax and enjoy. And this master is already doing the same thing. Third thing, we are not going to carry anything in our life. We are not going to carry anything in our life. Please be very clear. Even if the whole world worships you as a king, it is pure foolishness, nothing else. Two things. Mad people also claim they are king. People who are sitting in the throne, they also claim they are kings. Why somebody is put in the asylum or somebody is respected? If this guy is cunning enough to convince others to believe what he says, he is respected and made to sit in throne. People who are innocent, people who are not so cunning, people who are not able to frighten others to believe what they are saying, they are put in the asylum, that's all. Otherwise, there is no difference between a person who is sitting in the asylum and claiming he is a king and a person who is sitting in a throne and claiming he is a king. Person who is sitting in a throne and claiming he is a king, he is cunning, or somehow he is able to torture the people or threaten the people, frighten the people to believe what he says. The person who is sitting in asylum, he doesn't have that much of cunningness, that's all. In existence, there is no mad person, there is no king. Both are one and the same. The person who has got enough of courage or enough of capacity to frighten the others, who can make others believe what he says is truth, he sits in the throne. Who doesn't have that much of cunningness, he is in the asylum. Small story. One guy suddenly started thinking, not only thinking, started claiming he is Jawaharlal Nehru in India. That time Jawaharlal Nehru was the president, was a prime minister. He was the prime minister of India. He started claiming he is Jawaharlal Nehru. He just starts claiming it's okay. He started dressing. That is also okay. He started writing letters to all officials and started signing like Jawaharlal Nehru. Anyhow, naturally, he was taken to asylum. 6 months he was treated. After all the treatment, he started behaving almost normal. Doctor said, I think now he can be discharged. The day he was about to be released, fortunately or unfortunately, Jawaharlal Nehru himself visited the asylum. He himself came to the asylum as a visit. They brought this patient to Nehru and introduced, sir, he is the person who started claiming he is Jawaharlal Nehru. After the formal introduction, this patient, he asked Nehru, who are you? Nehru said, I am Jawaharlal Nehru. The patient said, please be here for 6 months, they will make you all right. Don't worry. Be here for 6 months, they will make you all right. You will become all right. Understand, there is no difference between these two. Somehow, one is able to convince others what he is speaking is truth. The other one is not able to convince, that's all. There is no other big difference. In existence, there are no boundaries. In existence, there is no host. The person who thinks or can convince others in a cunning way, he becomes king. Even if you become king, that doesn't fulfill anything. That doesn't give you anything. Never think having the outer space or having comforts the outer world will give you inner fulfillment. Never. Never it will give. All developed countries are filled with depression. All developed countries are filled with depression. They have best roads, best dams, best bridges, best infrastructure, but people are depressed. But people are depressed. All developed countries are drowning in depression. Never think the outer space will give you the inner space. Inner space, if you want the inner space, if you want to achieve the inner space, you need to work for inner space. You need to understand the dynamics of inner space. You need to understand the technology of inner space. Here, Krishna is giving you the technology of inner space. Let me give you a small diagram, then we will enter into the next sutra, next sloka. How we work, or how our mind moves, this is your being. Material life is a horizontal line and vertical life is a spirit, vertical line is a spiritual life. Continuously, always we fight or we try to choose something. You continuously bother whether to choose the horizontal line or vertical line, whether to go in this path or in this path. We are always stuck somewhere here or somewhere here. You try to move, you are caught in the dilemma whether to go to this end or that end. Mind is dilemma. Mind is nothing but dilemma. Whatever path you choose,
whether the material life or spiritual life, you will always feel you are missing the other part. You will continuously feel you are missing something. One important thing, as long as you think your mind, as long as you live with the mind, you will have this problem of material life and spiritual life. But if you can just drop into the being, if you can just forget about the goal which is here, this is the purpose, you are continuously running towards it. The running towards the purpose. Running towards the purpose. One more thing. Just like you have goals in the material life, people have got goals in the spiritual life also. There are so many people who wants, I should meditate for 7 hours. I should become enlightened. I should become that. I should do this. I should be that. Please be very clear, goal in the material life and goal in the spiritual life, both make you mad. If you want to become mad, continuously think of any goal. Straight way to become mad. Nothing else needs to be done. Simple technique to become mad is remember about some goals. The more you are bothered about goals, you will not be able to live the path. For example, a teacher, if he is continuously bothered about salary, he will never be able to see the faces of students. He will be seeing only the face which is printed in the dollar bill. He will never be able to see the face of the student. Same way, the man who is caught in the goal will never be able to live the life. Man is continuously bothering, thinking about the goal, will never be able to enjoy the simple things which is around him. He can't smile at a flower. He can't stop to see the nature. He can't live anything. He will be continuously running, running, running behind the printed paper, dollar bill, which has no value basically. The money is nothing but utility. We run behind the utility. We run behind things for something. We achieve things, but we never achieve what far we want to achieve. The man is running behind the goal, running behind the material goal. He will always feel he is missing the spiritual goal. One more basic secret. Understand? All rich community will always go to spiritual masters. All rich community, invariably, they will always go to the spiritual masters. Because deep guilt is there inside them that they are missing spirituality. All rich communities will always go and will always have strong gurus. See, in every society, if the community is rich, means they will have strong gurus. Because a deep guilt is there that they are missing spirituality. They are missing spirituality. Same way, the person who took this choice will always be running behind rich man. The person who took this choice will always be running behind rich man, will always be behind the rich man. And the person who took this choice will always be running behind this man. It is both fulfilling each other. This guy wants to fulfill the other person is trying to fulfill this person. Please be very clear. That is why the so-called religious men and the so-called rich men, both are always trying to be together. You can always see these two will be together, because this guy needs him and this guy needs him. Both are feeling they are missing the other. This guy feels he is missing this, and this guy feels he is missing this. Both are trying to fulfill each other cerebrally. His ideal is fulfilled by him. His ideal is fulfilled by him. The person who took this choice, he feels if these rich men are around him, what he is missing will be fulfilled. Same way, the person who took this choice, he feels if he goes to a spiritual man, a religious man, he will be fulfilled. Both are helping each other. Both are helping each other. The man who realizes the purposelessness of this goal, the purposelessness of the running, he just falls back into his being. If you realize whatever you kept as purpose or the goal in your life, it is purposeless, it is useless. The moment you realize, the moment the glamour is gone, the moment the inspiration or which makes the person, I can't say it is inspiration, it's just a perspiration because it just continuously makes you perspire. The moment the purpose is gone, the moment the respect for the purpose is gone in your life, you simply fall into your being. One important thing, the moment you fall into your being, you explode. Not only you start flowing in the direction of horizontal and vertical line, you explode in 360 degree in all dimensions. Whatever you can imagine and what you can't imagine, you start exploding in all the directions. Only then you become multidimensional being. A man who has fallen into his being means who has dropped the goals, who understood the purposelessness of existence, who has realized, who tasted the beauty of purposelessness, he falls into his being, into his Atman, and he explodes into 360 degree in all dimensions. He starts experiencing the ultimate bliss of spiritual life and ultimate happiness of material life and something more. Only he enters into the eternal bliss, Krishna consciousness. As long as you are caught with this goal or this goal, goal in the material life or goal in the spiritual life, you travel only in that line because you think you are a body or mind. More you are caught with a purpose, the more you will think you are body or mind. The moment you realize the purposelessness, you straight away fall into the abyss of your being. You experience your Atman, you relax, your inner wounds are healed. The first inner wound is thinking yourself as body and mind. That is the original sin. Please be very clear. The original sin is thinking yourself as body and mind. Don't think Adam eating apple is the original sin. No. Why should we suffer for his sin? Why should we suffer for his sin? Surely we don't have to suffer for his sin. The original sin is not Adam eating apple, it is you thinking yourself as body or mind. When you have the purpose, when you think of the purpose of the life, you think you are body or mind. When you realize the purposelessness, you just drop into your being. The moment you drop into your being, you explode. Your inner wounds are healed. Understand this one thing. If you can understand this one thing, this moment you can become enlightened. Actually, any
single individual to become enlightened. You don't need whole Gita. Single sloka is enough. Single Gita sloka is enough to make any individual enlightened. Why I am speaking on all the slokas? Because there are so many different kinds of individuals. This is a key for different individuals. That is the reason I am explaining all the slokas. If you can fall in yourself, just look into yourself and understand this one sloka for yourself, not for going and explaining to your wife, not for going and explaining to your mother-in-law, not for going and explaining to your friend, not for going and explaining to somebody else. Please be very clear. Whenever I speak, understand I am speaking to you. Don't prepare notes in your mind to go and repeat it to somebody else. When you prepare notes, I should go and tell this to my friend. I should go and tell this to my husband. When you prepare notes mentally to go and repeat it to somebody, you will miss experiencing it. Just allow this one idea to work on you. The purposelessness of life. You can just close your eyes and think, contemplate 2-3 minutes, few moments. Really, what is the purpose of my life? What for I am doing what I am doing? Where am I going? What is happening? Just if your inner eye opens, if your inner space understands the beauty of purposelessness, that is enough, you will fall into your being. When you fall into your being, you explode into 360 degree. In all dimensions, you explode, you experience totally different kind of material life and totally different kind of spiritual life. As on now, you can neither experience spiritual life nor experience material life. Because when you are here, you are looking there. When you are there, you are looking here. You can never experience anything in a solid way. Your mind is not with your body. You are not living inside your boundary. Always the other side of the bank looks greener. Always something else is calling you. Only when you experience the beauty of purposelessness, you will be able to understand what Krishna says throughout the Karma Yoga. Please take few minutes, close your eyes and look into yourself. Sincerely ask yourself, let this understanding work on you. Let this idea sink into your being. Honestly ask why you are doing what you are doing, where you are going. What do you think as the purpose? Take few minutes and look. Whatever you think as purpose, even if you achieve, it is not going to be with you. It is not going to stay with you. The beauty of the whole existence is purposeless. Let this one idea sink in your being. Let this go deep into your inner space. Let it do its alchemy on you. understand this one thing. Just understanding this one single idea can transform your whole way of thinking, can transform your whole way of working, can transform your whole way of living. When you understand there is no purpose in totality, you will start enjoying every single moment. You will start living intensely every single inch. Every moment will become meaningful. When you think the as a whole, there is a purpose, the every single moment will lose its meaning. If you think your whole 30 days of working is worth of $100,000 or $50,000, you will judge your 1 month only as a $50,000. Please be very clear, your life is not $50,000 worth. For example, you think that 1 month of your life is $50,000. So if you calculate your whole life, it may come for some 10 million or 20 million or even 100 million. Suddenly somebody says, I'll give you 100 million, give you your life. Will you be able to give up? Logically, this is the way you are calculating and working. This is the way we are calculating and working. We are ready to sell our mind. We are ready to sell our moments, ready to sell our inner space, calculating the value of our life. Logically, you fix a rate for your life. Once you fix the rate, only the rate is in your inner space. You forget that doing the work itself or living itself is beautiful. If you think the whole has got purpose, the part loses the meaning. Understand, as a whole, the whole has no purpose. The moment you realize the whole has no purpose, the part will become meaningful. Your very living, every day itself will become beautiful. Every day your life, you are living, you are sitting, you are walking, you are standing, everything is joyful experience. That is why they say that Satchit Ananda means bliss of very existence. Your very existence is blissful. You don't have to think in the end you will have the bliss. No, your very existence is blissful. The moment you drop the goal, your path becomes blissful. The moment you realize the beauty of purposelessness, your very existence becomes meaningful. The meaning of existence is bliss, eternal bliss, Nitya Ananda. The next sloka says, Nahi gacchit kshanamapi jadu tishtatya karma krit karya deyava sakkarma sarva prakriti jair gunai. Nahi gacchit kshanamapi jadu tishtatya karma krit karya deyava sakkarma sarva prakriti jair gunai. Everyone is forced to act helplessly according to the qualities he has acquired from the modes of material nature. Therefore, no one can refrain from doing something, not even for a moment. Usually people ask me, Swamiji, if you say that life is purposeless, why should we work? Let us lie down. Who will give me food? I tell you, you can never lie down. You may lie down for next 4 or 5 days because you always go to this extreme. Now the pendulum is in this extreme. If you take the hand, it will go to this extreme. Maximum 1 week you will be able to lie down.
After that, you can't lie down. By your very nature, you will start doing the work. By your very nature, you will start doing the work. All I mean when I say life is purposeless, I am not asking you to just lie down in your home. I am asking, let your body and mind work without disturbing your inner space. You don't have to sell your inner space to have outer place. You don't have to sell your inner bliss to have outer comforts. By very nature, here Krishna gives the assurance. By your very nature, your body and mind will work. Just if you keep quiet, that is enough, they will function beautifully. Somebody came and asked me, Swamiji, to do right thing, what should I do? How should I keep my mind to do right thing? I told him, just keep quiet. Automatically your body and mind will do the right thing. Just if you get out of your system, that's enough. Divine will get in. All we need to do is just get out. Divine will get in. By nature, he says, Prakriti Jair Gunai. By very nature, your body and mind knows the right thing. But you never trust your body and mind. You never trust your body and mind. You always trust your ego, which finally dumps you in the dustbin. But you never trust the body and mind. Be very clear. Your body and mind by nature will do the work. All you need to do is keep quiet, relax from your ego. Don't think your inner space is needed for the outer work. The person who understood what is nitya and what is anitya, the person who understands what is eternal and what is ephemeral and relaxes into the eternal is always in eternal consciousness. He always resides in nitya ananda. Krishna says, a man who relaxes into nitya ananda and does his job, does his work, he is karma yogi. Just relax into your inner space, automatically you will be guided. You will be guided. We always think, if I relax in my mind, thinking that life is purposeless, how will I know which is right and which is wrong, Swamiji? How will I know which is right and which is wrong? Please be very clear. The more you worry about which is right and wrong, you will not do any mistake. You will commit blunders. The person who worries which is right and which is wrong continuously will commit only blunders. He will never commit mistakes. The person who doesn't worry, who never bothers, he may do small mistakes. But the person who continuously worries will never do small mistakes, he will commit big blunders. And I tell you, to take this jump of not worrying needs courage. Even if you do one or two mistakes, what is the wrong? Taking the risk and jumping and start living without worrying is what I call dhiratva, courage. Courage of entering into the spiritual life. When you take the jump, you will do naturally one or two small mistakes. Don't worry. Putting up with that mistake is what I call tapascharya. Tapas. Tapas is nothing but accepting the small mistakes which you do when the conscious transition happens in your being. When you move from ephemeral consciousness to eternal consciousness. When you move from worry to bliss, when you move from asatya to satya, you will do one or two mistakes. You will fall and raise, just like a small child when he tries to walk.
It will always fall once or twice. Just because of that, can you say, don't start walking? No. Even if it does one or two small mistakes, it has to stand up and start walking. That one or two small mistakes, once or twice falling and trying to stand up, is what is tapas done to learn how to walk. Same way, when you start living without mind, in the initial level, you may commit one or two mistakes. Don't worry. That is tapas charya. That is tapas. Have courage and just enter into the zone of no mind. Enter into the zone of eternal consciousness. Simply start living. Realize the purposelessness of the existence. Decide, today onwards, I will live without worrying. Because life is too small to be spent in worrying. Life is too small to be spent in worrying. Life is too short to be spent in worrying. So never bother, never worry about your goals. Just drop the goals. The moment you understand the beauty of purposelessness, all the wounds which you have created in your inner space will be healed. You will fall into the abyss of eternal bliss. Next, Krishna says, this is one of the important point, one more point, he clarifies. Ye me madamidam nityam anudishtanti manava shraddha vanto nasuyanto mucchante vikarmabhi. The translation goes, those persons who execute their duties according to my injunctions and who follow this teaching faithfully, without envy, become free from the bondage of fruitive actions. Here you need to understand two things. He says, according to my injunctions, means when you enter into your being, whatever your being says is Krishna's words. When he says my injunction, he means the injunction from Atman. Injunction from the being, the Paramatman. When you drop the goals and fall into your being, you will be straight away guided by the divine. You will be guided by the nature. You will be guided by God himself. You will become an instrument in his hand. If you become hollow bamboo without any blockage inside, you will become a flute in the hands of Krishna. Dropping your purposes or dropping your ego is what I call becoming a hollow bamboo. If you become a hollow bamboo, you will become flute in the hands of Krishna. If you are a solid bamboo, you will be used only to carry dead bodies. In India, solid bamboos are used only to carry the dead bodies. Same way, if you drop the ego and fall into the being, you will become instrument in the hands of divine. You will become a divine flute. When you become flute, the air which enters into you comes out as a music. Same way, when you become an instrument in the divine's hand, the air which enters into you comes out as a shastra or mantra or the music. Whatever comes out of you becomes divine. Your words become mantra. Your actions become tantra. Your form is yantra. The moment you drop the ego, your words become mantra to guide people. Your form becomes yantra to be meditated on. Your actions become tantra, technique to realize the Atman. you become divine. If you carry your ego just like a solid bamboo is used only to carry dead bodies, you will also be carrying this dead body. Now it is up to you whether to become hollow bamboo and become a flute in the hands of Krishna, or to be a solid bamboo and carry the dead bodies to smashana. If you drop into your being, you will become an enlightened being. You will become an instrument in the hands of the divine. Your words will become mantra. Your form will become yantra. Your actions will become tantra. Instead, if you decide to carry your ego, you will be carrying this dead body wherever you go. Here, he says, those persons who execute their duties according to my injunctions, according to your inner consciousness, please be very clear, as long as you carry the goal of the society, the purposes conditioned on you by the society, you will be carrying conscience. The moment you drop the social conditioning, the purposes taught to you by society, you will start living with consciousness. Social conscience is different and spiritual consciousness is different. If you live with goals, you will carry the social conscience in your life. If you realize the beauty of purposelessness, you will carry the spiritual consciousness in your life. The man who lives according to his consciousness, believing, having Shraddha towards these teachings. Why Krishna is demanding Shraddha? Here is the first place where Krishna says Shraddha, faithfully. Why? Shraddha vanto nasuyanto. He says, of course, the word Shraddha cannot be translated as faith. Faith is a very poor word for Shraddha. Please forgive me, I have to tell the truth. In English, there is no word for Shraddha exists, because the very idea of Shraddha never existed. Let me be clear. The very idea of Shraddha never existed here. That is why the word, equivalent word for Shraddha doesn't exist. Shraddha does not mean faith. Shraddha means faith plus courage to execute that idea. Courage to experiment with that idea is Shraddha. Courage to experiment, that idea is what is Shraddha. Here Krishna says, Shraddha vando nasuyanto. Man who executes these teachings with Shraddha, courage to follow. Why we need courage to follow? Small story. One born blind man goes to a doctor and asks, doctor, will you help me to have my eyes? Doctor says, don't worry, I'll do some operation, you will have your eyes, after that you can walk without that stick. The blind people, they always carry a stick to feel the road. You can walk without that stick. Now the blind man asks, doctor, I understand you will do an operation. I understand I'll have my eyes back. But I don't understand, how can I walk without stick? How can I walk without stick? By and by, the blind man forgot the stick is from outside. He started thinking, stick is necessary even for walking. But till the operation, till he gets his eyes, he has to have Shraddha towards the doctor's words and lie down in the operation table. Same way, I tell you, just live without mind, just live without purposes and goals. You will be able to walk
without stick. Stick is worrying. But you can never think you can live without worrying. By and by, worrying has become your part. So we can never imagine we can also survive, we can be alive without worrying. When I say you can live without worrying, you say, no, 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 Swamiji, how can it be possible? If I don't worry, what will happen to my children? What will happen to my house? What will happen to my wife? What will happen to my family? What will happen to my property? What will happen to my lawsuits? Please be very clear. Never think because of you, your life is going smoothly. In spite of you, it is going smoothly. Understand? Never your life is going smoothly because of you. In spite of you, it is going smoothly. The moment you have the courage to have Shraddha to these teachings and start living, dropping the purposes, only then you will realize you don't need stick to walk. You don't need stick to walk. Once you enter into the being, the depth of your being, you will enter into a totally different dimension. Whatever now you think as spiritual life or material life, both will lose its meaning. You will enter into a new dimension of life. For example, can you explain for 4-year-old small child the life of marriage? Can you explain what is life to a 4-year-old child? You can't. He can't understand. But he can understand only toys. He can understand only dolls. He can only play with toys. Once he reaches the age of 25, naturally he will be able to understand what is life. Automatically toys and dolls will drop him. Do you feel that you are missing your toys? Do you feel that you have renounced your toys? No. The moment you grow, you start experiencing a different dimension of your life. When you experience a different dimension of your life, automatically the small things drops you, and you drop them, they drop you. Not even you dropping them is important. They dropping you is important. You dropping smoking is not important. Smoking dropping you is important. When you enter into your being, when you enter into the purposelessness of life, the whole so-called material life and spiritual life drops you, and you enter into a different dimension of life. A new dimension, that is what I call quantum spirituality or eternal consciousness. You reach the eternal bliss. You start living in eternal bliss. Now you may have a serious doubt. How can I walk? How can I live without worrying? I tell you, your doubt is nothing but the same doubt this blind man is asking. How can I walk without stick? You cannot convince that blind man you can walk without stick till he gets the eyes. Only after he gets the eyes, he will be able to understand he doesn't need stick to walk. Same way, only when you reach the being, you will understand you don't need worries to live. You don't need mind, you don't need worrying mood to live. Till you reach the being, you need to have Shraddha. Till you get your eyes, you need to have Shraddha and lie down in the operation table. You need to allow the doctor to work on you. That is the reason Krishna is asking Shraddha vanto nasuyanto. Next word, beautiful word, anasuyanto, means without envy. This is an important thing.
Whatever I said, every one of us are able to understand. It's really great, Swamiji. What you said is right. But suddenly, the moment one thought comes, my brother has purchased 2 houses. My sister is getting new big car. How can I live just like this? The moment you get some thought, he is having that, he is having this, what happens? All your spirituality, all your purposelessness, all your spiritual philosophy, everything just disappears. You are again on the same rat race. He says, without envy. Envy is the thing which puts you again in that same rut. In the same rut. One great problem in the rat race is, even if you win, you are a rat. Even if you win, you are a rat. Nothing more than that. Please be very clear. The moment envy, jealous enters into your being, whole thing disappears. You start again running into the social conditioning. You start running behind the purposes. You start running behind the goals. Envy or jealousy is the thing which makes you run like a rat. Run like a rat. There is a beautiful, another one idea in Tantra. Maya Shakti. This Maya makes us all dance just with this one stick called jealousy. Have you seen the monkey charmers in India? The roadside. Roadside, they will do a small show with monkeys. They will have a small stick. They will just rotate that stick and shout, arraram, arraram, arraram. They will just say, give the instructions to that monkey. According to their instruction, that monkey will do everything. This stick, with this stick, they will make the monkey dance. With a small stick, they will make the monkey to dance and do whatever they want. Same way, the Maya Shakti is making you run as she wants, just with one stick called jealousy, envy, comparison. The moment you compare, you just again jump into the same path, same rut, same routine, which I call the purpose life. Then you became karmi, not karma yogi. Man who lives in the eternal consciousness, nitya ananda, and allows his body and mind to work according to its nature, is centered on eternal consciousness. He is called karma yogi. But the man, out of jealousy, out of envy, out of comparison, who jumps, enters into the social conditioning, social rut, the same routine of rat race, is called karmi. The difference between karmi and the karma yogi is only one thing. The man who is driven by jealousy is karmi. The man who allows the eternal consciousness to drive him is called karma yogi. All you need to understand is only this one word. Without envy, anasuyanto, without jealousy. The moment you start thinking, oh, he is having all those things, he is having all those things, you become mad. If a neighbor brings AC into his house, your house temperature increases. Your house temperature increases. One more thing. When we do things out of comparison, we do all foolish things. Our intelligence stops working. our intelligence completely stops working. Small story. A priest and a rabbi, they were staying opposite to each other. Not only they were staying opposite to each other, they are opposite to each other. If a priest brings rose garden to his house, within 24 hours, rabbi will bring new rose garden. If a rabbi paints his house in white, within 24 hours, priest's house also will be painted in white. Suddenly one day, in front of rabbi's house, a new Mercedes Benz was standing. This is too much for priest. Somehow he did something. Within 24 hours, not only he brought the Rolls Royce, he started sprinkling some holy water on it. Rabbi saw from his house and asked, "Hey, what happened to you? You have got the new Rolls Royce, it's okay. But till yesterday you were all right. Why today morning you started sprinkling water on the car? Why you started sprinkling water on the car?" Priest says, "I am a religious person. I cannot travel in a car which is not Christian. So I am baptizing it. I am baptizing it." Now the rabbi is in a big trouble. What to do? That day evening, he is seen cutting the exhaust pipe of the Benz with AXA frame. If you understand. If you have not understood, ask the people who are laughing. To convert the car into Jew, that day evening, rabbi started cutting the exhaust pipe with AXA frame. If you do things out of jealous, out of enviousness, out of comparison, we will end up only doing this type of foolish things. Intelligence will stop working. When you start comparing, intelligence stops working. Please understand, every one of you are unique. There is no need to compare. There is no need to compare with other person. You are unique. The main problem is you compare only with the nearest persons. 5 inch up and 5 inch low. Only with that persons you compare. You don't compare yourself with Bill Gates, do you? If you compare, even God cannot save you. That is different. You don't. You compare only with your neighbor. You compare only with your colleague. You compare only with your brother. You compare only with your sister. The problem is not even failure. Your worry about the failure is the problem. That is why you don't compare with unreachable goals. You compare only reachable goals. You compare only with immediate persons. Understand, this comparison is what is driving you crazy. Again and again and again brings the whole social conditioning on you and eats away your whole life. Your whole life is eaten away by this one maya called comparison. Your whole joy, ecstasy, bliss, the very bliss or the ecstasy of living is swallowed by this one maya called comparison. How the whole thing is swallowed at the time of Pralaya by the ocean, same way, just this one concept, comparison, one idea, envy and jealousy, swallows your whole life, which has no existence. Two things. There is something called comparative reality and something called existential reality. If you build your life based on the existential reality, you will never suffer. If you build your mind and comparative reality, you will be continuously suffering even at the time of death. Not at the time, not only at the time of death, even after death. Don't build your inner space on comparative reality. Let your inner space be built on existential reality. Let you accept the life as it is. If you build your life on existential reality, you will live your life blissfully in eternal consciousness as Karma Yogi. Small story. One guy comes to the bar with a big smile, big grin is in his face, and asks the bartender to serve drink for the whole house freely. Give drink for everybody, I'll pay you. Bartender serves and asks, it's so nice, I'm very happy you did a good thing for everybody. May I know why you did this? He said, I'm very happy today. I have grown taller than my younger brother. I became taller than my younger brother. My younger brother used to be taller than me. So always people tease. You are elder or he is elder? So I had a problem. Today I have grown taller than my younger brother. And younger brother taller than you is really problem. If your elder brother taller than you, it can be at least tolerated. Younger brother taller than you is too much. Today, I became taller than him. He asked, how? In this age, how suddenly you have grown and became taller than him? No, no, I have not grown. He met with accident, his both legs have been amputated. When you compare, when we live with jealousy, when our life is based on comparative reality, please be very clear, we end up only in this type of things. Let your inner space be built on existential reality, not on comparative reality. So, next, the Krishna says, beautiful thing. Tasmadasakta sadatam karyam karma samachara asakto hyacharan karma paramapno dipurushaha. Therefore, one should do his duty without being desirous to the rewards of action, for by working without attachment, one attains the supreme. The whole essence of Karma Yoga. So understand, because of all these reasons, drop your attachment to the purpose, drop your attachment to the goal, and live the happy life, live the life blissfully, you will achieve the supreme. Tasmad asakta sadatam karyam karma chamachara asakto hyacharan karma paramapnodi purushaha. He says, you will achieve the supreme. You will achieve the eternal consciousness, Nitya Ananda. So, let us pray to the ultimate divine, Parabrahma Krishna, to make us all understand his great message, to make us all imbibe him in our being. Let him guide us, let him make us experience the eternal consciousness, eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you.
Vasudeva Sudham Devam Gamsa Chanura Mardanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum.
थैंक यू.